forward.
Ho, my comrades, see the signal waving in the sky. Reinforcements now appearing. Victory is nigh. Hold the fort, for I am coming. Jesus' signal still. Wave the answer back to heaven. By thy grace we will see the mighty host advancing, Satan leaving none. Mighty men around us falling, courage almost gone. Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus' signal still. The glorious banner waving, hear the trumpet blow. In our leader's name we'll triumph over every foe. Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus' signal still. Fierce and long the battle rages, but our help is near. Onward comes our great commander, cheer my comrades, cheer.
Come, Lord Jesus, come, please, Lord Jesus.
Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus' signal still. There's a peace in my heart that the world never gave. A peace in our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Doth ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. The windows of heaven are open, the blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart, since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my old tattered garment, he gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on manna from heaven, and that's why I'm happy, and that's why I'm happy, and that's why I'm happy tonight. The windows of heaven are open, the blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart, since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my old tattered garment, he gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on manna from heaven, and that's why I'm happy, and that's why I'm happy, and that's why I'm happy tonight. Amen. Praise God.
Would you honor God's word by standing as I read it this afternoon? Psalm 121, verse 1 through 8. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Please bow with me for a word of prayer. Father, I come into your presence knowing that this is a spiritual work. The songs have been a spiritual work as well. But Lord, we just want to come in contact with you and with heaven. We want the Lord Jesus Christ to be preeminent, to be in the forefront even of what things we look at. And so I just pray that you would continue to help us. Lord, we're not here just to show off. We're not here to waste time. We're here because we love you with all of our heart and all of our soul and all of our mind and all of our strength. We love you because you first loved us, your Son, Jesus Christ, sent so that we might have eternal life. And it's He, that wonderful, blessed Savior, that we lift up this afternoon. Lord God, you know, I don't really feel good. It's my own fault, I know. I've overscheduled myself for these last 3 weeks. But Lord, I just pray that my not feeling the best would just be put aside, and that you'd work, that you'd take these sacred words that you've preserved for us on these pages and put it into the hearts of these dear ones that are before me in such a way that they would grow in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My prayer is for them, Lord. And so as I ask for that unction once again, I don't ask because I want to look good. I want to be thought of as good, but I want them to grow. I want them to be elated. I want them to go out of here with a great dimension of newness of Christ in their life. And so just help them, encourage them, strengthen them, and I'll praise you and thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, dear ones. You may be seated. Remember, we're looking at these 15 Psalms uniquely titled A Song of Degrees. And this group is here because it's about to take us from where we are closer to the realms of heaven. Take us out of the nasty now and now, this old world we walk in, and get us up there closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. From the mediocre Christian life up to something that's just really overflowing with Jesus in all that we do. And there's songs of degrees, and just like on a thermometer, we have degrees, and they either tell us things are going up or they tell us things are going down, as we watched last night. It brought the plants in again, and you know, all that kind of thing. Maybe for naught, who knows, but you know, those are degrees. And so as we look at each of these psalms, the thing that we want to notice is that they build. And it, within the psalm, within the verses of the psalm, there's a building. And then, of course, there's also a building in the grouping of psalms, these 15 psalms, that is a building. And last week, we took a look at Psalm 120, and we saw there that it built from, I've got a distress. And how do I get that distress? Well, I had that distress because of lying lips and a deceitful tongue. And where did I get those? Well, I got those because I sojourn in Meshach and I dwell in the tents of Kedar. I dwell, as verse 6 and 7 talks about, I dwell among people that hate peace and I really want peace. Amen. And so that's where I got this affliction, why I have this distress, and it built in that direction. Well, Psalm 121 is building on that. And remember, we also looked at the idea last week that these may be set up in such a way for those, you know, every year the men were required to make 3 pilgrimages to Jerusalem if they could. If they could afford it, they were to, every Jewish man was to make 3 times they were supposed to visit Jerusalem. And so they leave wherever they are. They're in Antioch, or they're in Ephesus, or they're in Rome. and they have to leave and go on to Jerusalem three times a year. And as they go, so these things help them as they get closer and closer to Jerusalem. It's kind of an unusual thing. Jerusalem, as a capital city, is unique in that it's built up on a hill and not near a body of water. You think about it, most capital cities are built on a valley and a plain near some kind of water, river, lake, something. But Jerusalem's built up on the top of a hill. It's quite different in that sense. And so, you know, to get to Jerusalem, wherever you were in Israel, you had to go up. Eventually, you had to go up to Mount Zion, to Israel, where the temple was and that kind of thing. And so, you know, these things are going up. Psalm 121 now is for us looking up. Remember there in 120 in verse 1, in my distress, so I called it affliction. Here in 121, I will lift up mine eyes, so I'm looking up. I'm looking up to the Lord. I'm looking up to where I'm going to get to. I'm anticipating getting there, getting up there, and that kind of thing. And, you know, God wants us to change our view. The view that we had in Psalm 120 was distress. I'm surrounded with people that are liars. Yeah, if the news media has its way, we're going to elect a lying female and put her into office as president. That's what the media wants. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, she's got lying lips and a deceitful tongue. Yeah. You know, and then we think about, we're dwelling in this whole place. They don't want peace. You know, they hate peace. I'm for peace, but they speak of war. You know, God wants us to change our perspective a little bit. Mm-hmm. We need to start looking up. All around us, we can see the doom and gloom. We can see the rotten and the wretchedness all around. God wants us to start looking up.
Amen.
We're going to get closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. Got to get our eyes off from the nasty now and now and think about that heavenly city. Think about those things above.
Amen.
So this psalm is important because our enemy, the devil, wants to keep us from getting closer to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Am I right about that?
Oh, yeah.
You know, he wants every Christian to be, you know, as bad as they can be, as bad off as they can be. You know, he wants them to be useless in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this psalm brings us a little farther, brings us farther up, closer to, you know, the heavens. And is a degree. We're moving up by degrees. We're not moving up by you know, leaps and bounds. This isn't a song of leaps. It's a song of degrees. Let's just go up a little more. Let's get a little closer here. And we'll get a little closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. So verse 1, if I can, start looking down through the verses. Verse 1 says, our help, you know, comes from not self, can never come from self. It can't. Our help from anywhere other than the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be a weak help. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. You know, now you have to think of yourself being in a flooded valley. I'm just amazed at what's going on in Texas. I'm surprised that my cousin down there hasn't called me up and said, Billy, stop praying for rain. We don't need any more rain. Mm-hmm. I'm surprised she hasn't called up and said that. I mean, Texas is having floods that they've never had. They've never seen floods like they're having there. You know, people that have lived there all their life said, we've never seen it like this. Can you picture yourself in a flooded plain, you know, down there if you want to get to a specific spot nearby enough that we know about? Just think you're living in Marathon in the spring and that river is flowing over. I mean, it floods. I've seen where I've seen that thing flood down through Marathon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, wouldn't you want to get to the hills?
Amen.
Wouldn't you want to get out of there? Wouldn't you be looking to the hills for some rescue?
Amen.
You know, you'd want to go up into the hills. You'd try to get up there for safety. And you know what's interesting is in a battle situation, the army that has the hills has the advantage. It's always that way. You know, it's just amazing. one of the times when we were at Bible College in North Carolina. It snowed, and I think it might have even snowed 3 full inches. And it was enough that you could make snowballs. So on campus, all the fellows wanted to make snowballs. Well, being that I lived in the married student dorm, we actually had access to the roof of the building where there was 3 inches of snow all over this flat-roofed building. So we were making snowballs, and it was easy to pelt those guys down there, especially since I was from the north, knew how to make them hard, packed, you know, throw them just right. Oh, it was. And then they're trying to throw those snowballs up at us, trying to hit us. It's a wonder we didn't break windows. You know that, Jenny? Those guys did, you know. And they could hardly do it. I mean, there wasn't one or two snowballs even made it onto the roof. But boy, we pelted them. Dave, they had snow down in places they never knew snow could get. It was amazing. Because we had the advantage. We were at the hill, as it were, top of the building, and they were down below. And it's that way that has the advantage. You know, you take a look there in Psalm 120, remember from last week, the sharp arrows of the mighty are what are going to be given to those with the lying lips. You know, when I talked about how the armies back in that day, they would have these marching men. They're just going to march together. They might have spears. They might have, you know, the buckler, which was the shield that had the point at the front. And they have swords when they get even closer. And they have all of that kind of thing, and armor in the front. But then the army that was smart would put archers on a hill over this way so that they could shoot into the side of that enemy. And then the enemy, they're vulnerable on the side, the back, you know, and if they turn to that, now they're vulnerable to the swords and spears coming at them this way. Now, what an advantage they would have. Of course, Satan knows that, throws those fiery darts at us. He knows how to do those kinds of things. But my help comes, you know, from the Lord. And whence cometh my help? From the hills is where it comes from. And, you know, God's always thought of as up high, above, up high in the hills kind of thing. He's always thought of as the higher one. And so that's where my help comes from. And if I didn't know that, verse 2 tells me. Verse 2 says, my help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. That's where my help comes from. No person can give me that kind of help. Nope. I myself can't give myself that kind of help. Nope. You know what I'm talking about? I can't get it from anywhere else. And since he is the one who made heaven and earth, that's what the verse says, which made heaven and earth, since he is that one that made heaven and earth and everything in it, he certainly has the power to help me. If I'm going to have any kind of help in this spiritual life, in this spiritual battle, he's the only one that can do it. Amen. And he's got the power to do it. And that's a great thing. So then we move on here to verse number 3, which says, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. And we know that the word suffer means to allow. Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me. Allow it to happen. Bring them unto me. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, little children, you know, there's a lot of work to them, and you need to bring them on to me. Just amazing little children, huh? At the wedding yesterday, my niece from California was there, and she had her baby, 15 months old now, baby, and she had one of them little car things, you know, them seat things with the handle at the top. And so they were moving from one spot to the where they're going to sit at the tables in the reception. And so I thought, well, let me carry the baby for you so you don't have to carry the baby. She said, sure, go ahead, carry the baby. Man, why pick that thing up? I thought, what in the world? This thing made out of lead? I couldn't believe how heavy that thing was, you know? And it turns out the baby can walk and everything. I was sleeping when I picked it up. Boy, it was heavy thing, so... Jesus said, suffer the little children. Yeah, there's some work to little children, you know, but he was willing to have them come, allow them to come, to suffer them to come. And so, verse 3, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. This is that one who made heaven and earth. He's not going to allow it. He's not going to let it happen. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. And that's a good thing for us. You know, we're pilgrims and we're on our way to heaven. Think about the pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem, you know, the different paths that they would have to go on. And he would keep them from moving off from that path. And so our path on our like, you know, getting to Christ's likeness, he's not going to suffer our foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber, it goes on and says here. And that's important for us as well. We're reminded that God does not slumber.
Amen.
There's no siesta time for God. You know, no power nap. You know, he never, you know, has a meal and gets groggy afterward like we do sometimes. Doesn't happen. You know, he's there to help us. Can you hold your finger here in Psalm 121, but look back in the Psalms to Psalm 38 and verse number 16, please. Psalm 38 and verse 16. And here, you know, in this one, excuse me, it does say a Psalm of David. Psalm 38, verse 16, for I said, hear me, lest otherwise they should rejoice over me. When my foot slippeth, they magnify themselves against me. You know, and it's got that overtone of it here about not just being able to walk on the path. It's got that overtone of not falling into sin, not being a disappointment to the Lord God. You know, that he's going to keep our foot from being moved. That's so important. Look, folks, when we were in that tour bus, and I don't know if it was because of the height that I was sitting or whatever, but when they were going around, that driver driving that thing in the mountains, and that road, here's the pavement, and right there is 4,000 feet below. I mean, here's the pavement, and right there, it looked like it was only that far. I mean, what's that?
That's not good.
That, you know, and he is not going 4 miles an hour. No. He's not going 5 miles an hour. You know, I mean, he's moving right along. I don't know what he was going. It was kilometers an hour anyhow. But that thing, you know, all it had to do is just a little, you know, or give way just a little. I'd have learned to yodel on the way down.
No thanks.
You know, but God kept that thing on there. At least on my side it did. I don't know about the other side, but I know on my side it did. You know, God did that, and he never slumbers. And see, now we're building on that, because verse 4 tells us, behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. And so we go on here to this great idea that if we understand the perpetual keeping of Israel, then we can understand how miraculous and how wonderful his keeping of us is. And it's true, you know, that he keeps Israel. Israel's been going on and on and on. They've tried to get rid of them. They've tried to destroy them. They've tried to overrun them. They've tried to, you know, wipe them out. But it just keeps going and going and going and going and going. It's amazing. It just keeps on. It just keeps on. It's just an incredible thing, you know, that the Lord has kept Israel. And, of course, we have to understand, you know, that that's a miraculous keeping that he's done. Now, some people have thought here about the, you know, this whole idea about him keeping Israel, that was talking about Jacob. Remember, God changed Jacob's name to Israel. And, you know, they're thinking on this that this was that time that Jacob is coming back to meet up again with Esau. And, you know, they parted as enemies. And, you know, Esau had said somehow, somewhere, and, you know, Jacob's and Esau's mom there, she overheard it, that Jacob said, I'm going to kill him as soon as Dad dies. Now, I'm not quoting scripture there, but that's what he was saying. That's why she told Jacob, you know, you get out of here. Well, Jacob had been there for all those years to get his wife and then got switched, so he had to work some more years to get the real wife. And so he's got all these kids, and he's got all his, you know, he's coming on back. And you remember he sent them all ahead, you know, so that they all get killed. Maybe he'd be done with killing. You know, he's killed all of them ahead of time. So when it gets to me, he's worn out. He's done with killing. And so he's all alone, you know. I mean, that's the Bible picture that we have there, and that God preserved him, God kept him. You know, in the desert there, I mean, he's got nothing but a rock for a pillow, stars for a blanket. That's all he's got, and he's wrestling with the Lord Jesus Christ. Mm. You know, where'd he come from?
Right.
Yeah, well, it's the fact that he neither slumbers nor sleeps. God doesn't ever slumber or sleep. You never have to wake God up. Don't have to worry about that. You know, there's no kind of drifting off that ever, ever happens. Dear ones, as I was studying for this message, I read this. And this is back in 18-something or others, 1889 or something like that. There was a ship captain who would take the ships, you know, from Liverpool, England to New York City. And he had decided that he wanted to move his family to New York. And so this particular voyage, he took his ship, as he did, but he had his whole family on the ship. Well, it sailing along, and one of the nights, you know, unexpected to any of them, a big gale came up. I mean, and it slapped into that ship, and it knocked that ship, and things went every which way. And you know, some of the sailors that were sleeping, they jumped up, you know, to get, you know, what do we have to do, and all that kind of thing. And, of course, it woke up any of the passengers, and the family woke up. The family was, oh, whoa, what's going on, what's going on? And the little girl said to her mom, "Mom, is Daddy on deck?" And the mom said, "Yeah, he's on deck." The little girl said, "Oh, okay." Went right back to sleep. Everybody else in a turmoil, the little girl just, you know how the Word of God talks about how we have to have the faith of children? The little girl just went right back to sleep because she knew her dad was on deck. He was in charge. He was taking care of it. They know verse 4. You know, the Lord God, he neither slumbers nor sleep. He takes care of everything for us. Amen? We don't have to worry about it. But let's move on in degrees. Verse 5 tells us now, the Lord is thy keeper. Remember, we're building here, so he's the keeper of Israel, but now it changes. The Lord is thy keeper. Not just Israel, thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. Verse 5 talks about there. He's not just an angel doing this. You know, we know that the Bible talks about those that know Christ as Savior. We have an angel assigned to us. We also know that the Bible talks about little children have an angel given to them, the ministering angel, you know, for them. And I think that it stays with them until they sin, you know, and then the angel backs off. And, you know, until they trust Christ as Savior, and then the angel comes. I mean, I really believe in a guardian angel. I know for myself there have been many a time where that angel has helped me. It's just incredible. Great blessing. But this is even greater than that. The Lord is thy keeper. Not just the angel. The Lord is, you know. And just think about it. Since the Lord is my keeper, Brother John, if the situation, you know, calls for it, the Lord can get 10,000 angels come right now, like that. Not just one. I mean, 10,000 of them, and he needs them. Right now, help this guy out. 10,000. Let's do it. And when you think about it, one angel slew all those Assyrians that were come against Jerusalem.
Amen.
10,000 of them, they'd do a good job, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of confident they'd do a good job. The Lord is thy keeper. Well, I don't have much to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad that the Lord is my keeper.
Amen.
But then they say something that's kind of interesting here, verse 5. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. Well, of course, the right hand is the idea of, you know, always being at the ready. you know, that we have things in the right hand, always at the ready kind of thing, but a shade upon thy right hand, you know, this idea of a shade. Now, you have to kind of think Asian, think Oriental. Remember, this is an Oriental book, and we're Occidental, we're Westerners, they're Easterners. You have to think on those ways. Here we are, touring all around Taiwan, and like I said, there's sometimes, there was 100 tour buses. Lord willing, if I can get to show you pictures, which just didn't get. I just didn't get to it for this week. But one of the pictures I'm going to show you is a nice, beautiful day. And here's all these Chinese people with umbrellas, because they don't want the sun to shine on them. They just don't want that to happen. So here's all, and there's all these umbrellas. I mean, the way I took the picture, they're going to look like a whole bunch of colorful armadillos, in the woods. Here's all these armadillos, it's all these parasols, if you will. the shade, think about it, shade's important for a desert person. For desert people, shade is important. You get burned up. And think about the pilgrim, trying to get to Jerusalem. He's going to have to cross some kind of desert somewhere. He needs some shade. And the Lord's going to be our shade. Think about it for us. There are a lot of times that our pilgrimage, our journey toward the Lord Jesus Christ, is going to take us through some desert spots. There's just going to be some times where it's just hot and dry. Doesn't seem like there's anything there. But the Lord still is our shade. We're building the Song of Degrees. So we go on to verse 6. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. Shade, you have to be shaded from the sun. So here it's building. And the sun shall not smite thee by day. And we know the effects of too much sun. Dehydration, sunstroke, and even death will happen if you get in. You're in the sun too much, and of course, then there's that thing. Well, I was just kind of running around in the sun, didn't think about it too much, and now I'm as red as a lobster, and now I got sunburn, and now I'm peeling every which way. And actually, you can get so sunburned that can be really bad, really, really bad for you. Get too much, and So we know that kind of thing. But, the moon being a problem, the moon by night. There is a difference being at the equator. The sunlight's different at the equator than it is where we live here, about 40 degrees north of the equator. It's different at the equator. That's why those countries along that equator, man, they're a lot different than our life is. Even being on Taiwan, being that much closer to the equator, that it was different. It really was. The sunlight was different there. Hit your eye at a different angle and that kind of thing. And so the moon, for those kind of people over in the Middle East and all, the moon is different. At the equator, it's brighter. It's a lot brighter than it is for us. And think about in a desert, not any humidity in the air, not a lot of that moisture in the air to filter that out. It's quite different. They talk about over there having moon blindness. Wow. That the moon make you see things you never thought you'd see, make your eyes play tricks on you and things like that. And, of course, what we know, even here in the Western culture, is that full moon, people become lunatics. That's right. Luna for Latin for moon. People go a little bit crazy. Not only that, but we also know that full moon time, women have more babies. There's a pull, there's a tug on them, during full moon time that makes the babies come out. So there's something about the moon. What goes in my mind? I kind of wonder, why is it that all the Muslim countries use the moon as part of their flag? And I know they worship the moon god. I mean, I know that's what they say. Allah is the same as our god, and you know, that's not true. But, you know, why is it? Why, what has the moon got to do with all of that for them? There's something there. There's some effect that the moon has on them. But it also made me think about the fact there, verse 6, of the Exodus protection. Remember what God did for those people as they came out of Egypt? They're in the wilderness. And what did God do? During the daytime, he had cloud. Can you imagine? There's not a cloud anywhere. Not a cloud anywhere except this cloud big enough to cover that million people that had come out of Egypt. All through the day, there's a cloud. Sometimes we think, oh, cloudy days, but they were thankful for it. They'd have burned up. Their cattle would have burned up. Those little children would have burned up. God put a cloud there. And then at night, what did he do for them? He put a fiery pillar. Now, something about fire is that it gives off light. And if that light's there, the moonlight isn't bothering you as much. At a fiery pillar, yeah, it kept things away from them. You know, the Egyptian army was afraid to attack, to go through that fiery pillar. But there was also that idea that it gave off some light to offset that moonlight. God was a protection for them.
Amen.
You know, a shade, you know, on the right hand, sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. But let's build a little bit more here, verse 7 and 8. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Did you notice that I used the word preserve three times in those two verses? Mm-hmm. Comes up those three times. It reminds me of the work of the Trinity. Think about it a little bit. Verse 7 says, the Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. You know, we're thinking about the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The Father preserving us from all evil. You know how it is there in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13. You know, when Jesus taught them to pray. You know, he said to them in Matthew chapter 6, after this manner, therefore, pray ye. Our Father, which art in heaven, as that starts out. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Asking the Father to deliver us from evil. Isn't that what our psalm says there?
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting, this song of degrees. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. But then we have to think a little bit more about that Trinity, and the next person of the Trinity is the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And what we have here in verse 7 is, he shall preserve thy soul. The Lord Jesus Christ is concerned with the soul's salvation. The Lord Jesus Christ is the one who paid the price so that we could be saved. The Lord Jesus Christ rose from the grave so that we could be saved, that our soul would be preserved. And the idea of preserved is preserved forever. Once saved, always saved. Amen? I mean, that's what preserving is. You know, when we put up things in canning, you know, we're trying to preserve them so that they can be used a long time after we put them in the can. And the Lord Jesus Christ preserves the soul. He makes sure our salvation. We get saved to the uttermost. I like that.
Amen.
Not just saved a little bit today. Not just saved maybe when we die. No, we're saved to the uttermost. Not only are we saved today, we're going to be saved when we die. We're going to be saved and be in heaven. It's going to be a great thing.
Amen.
Preserved. You know, the Lord preserves us from all evil. The Father does. The Son preserves thy soul. And then verse 8 talks about the fact, the Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. The Holy Ghost seals us. He's the third person of the Trinity. He seals us and then watches over our daily living. He's the one who directs us through the Word of God and by the Word of God, so that our going out and our coming in are pleasing unto the Father. And when we do something opposite to the words of God, then the Holy Spirit is grieved. The Holy Spirit is quenched. We resist the Holy Spirit. He just kind of shrivels up, and we can feel that. We can understand that. We can experience that. We can, get to that point where we know we've upset God somehow. And so that's how He works in us, to preserve our going out and our coming in, from this time forth and even forevermore. I'm glad that we didn't get the Holy Ghost for 5 years. And after that, you're on your own. You ought to be mature enough in 5 years. That's all. God says, okay. Just pretend. God says, all right, you got 5 years to grow up in the spiritual life. If you're not done in 5 years, oh, well, that's your problem. 5 years, that's it. That's all you get the Holy Ghost. After that, you're on your own. Boy, that'd be a terrible thing. Wouldn't it?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. I need the Holy Spirit now. 41 years after I've trusted Jesus Christ as Savior, as much as I did the first year that I trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I still rely upon the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, open my eyes that I might behold wondrous things out of thy law. I pray that kind of thing. Holy Spirit, lead my mouth to say these things and not those things. Lead me in these kind of things. I ask the Father to do that through the Holy Spirit. And that's some great things. So I'm looking up, and I need to see that my help comes from the Lord. I'm looking up, and I have to understand that as I'm looking up, God's going to protect my feet, and He's going to keep my way. And He does that because He doesn't slumber nor sleep, and He's been doing that with Israel for all these years. 6,000 years He's been doing this. And He's going to make sure that everything about me is protected. Now, does that mean that I won't ever get in a car accident? Well, no, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that I'm never going to fall and, break open my head on the racquetball court. It doesn't mean that. But it means that spiritually, I'm going to make it through.
Amen.
Amen? Spiritually, I'm going to get there. I'm going to get to the end. And I'm going to get closer to the Lord. It's going to happen. And He's lifting me up. If I'm only moving closer to God, I had better have a goal in sight. If I'm ever going to get closer to God, better aim at something. I'd better look up. I'd better lift my eyes up at something. If I'm going to get there, I have to have a goal in sight. And once I fix that goal on the Lord Jesus Christ and really start moving toward Him, then I can leave the old behind. Amen? And not only can I leave the old behind, but I can rest assured that God's going to help me to get to the goal that I want to be. The Apostle Paul said, I press toward the mark for the prize, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I press toward that mark. There's a mark there. There's a mark for you folks. There's a mark somewhere. The Lord Jesus Christ, you press toward it. What God does for us is just amazing. He'll protect and preserve you along the way.
Amen.
You want to get closer to the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
He'll do it. Just start looking up.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Father, I come again into your presence in prayer and just thank you and praise you. You're a great God. You really are. Thank you for being able to help us as we get our help from thee. You're the one who made the heavens and the earth. And so you're plenty strong enough to preserve us and to protect us and to keep our foot from slipping. For Lord, when our foot slips, the enemy laughs. When we sin in front of lost people, the enemy laughs. Whether it's the devil or whether it's lost people, they laugh at us, make a mockery of our Savior. And I don't want that. I want to be closer to the Lord. And I know these folks want to be closer to you, dear Jesus. They wouldn't come back if they didn't want to grow closer to you. And so I pray that you'd help them. May they understand that you are a shade upon their right hand. The sun will not smite them, nor the moon. That you've preserved them, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, in your three aspects of ministry, although you're one God. You've preserved us, and I'm thankful for it. Bless us now. May we have a good week. May we remember those that served and died, and may we come back again on Wednesday rejoicing that we are able to serve our Savior. And we'll thank you now for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen,
amen, dear ones. I love you. A song of degrees. I hope I've moved.